I work at the Royal Free Hospital in the liver transplant department, and I'm going to bring to this talk my experience of managing patients with end-stage liver disease and general liver transplantation, and try and give you an idea about what the problems we have generally and how they really resonate within the HIV community, and especially the changes that are happening in liver transplantation both in the UK and worldwide that might impact on your patients as they, hopefully not, but as they may come to transplantation. So the first thing to say, it's a great time to be involved in hepatology, certainly in Northern Europe and Britain. We have quite high rates of liver disease-related mortality. There's plenty of business. The majority of this is related to alcohol, certainly in Northern Europe. This estimate for the UK, where I work, is lower than France and Germany, but is increasing. You see relatively low levels of alcohol-related mortality in Southern Europe, but that's counteracted by an increased prevalence of HCC-related death, which reflects the higher prevalence of viral hepatitis in these countries. So there's plenty of liver disease around, and in the UK, we're not really winning the battle. Whereas we've managed to get on top of deaths from stroke, cancer, chest disease, diabetes, and ischemic heart disease, the only growing cause of mortality in under 65s in the UK is liver disease. So we're facing an epidemic of liver disease in the UK, whereas unlike the football, we managed to succeed over other European countries in terms of increasing that activity year on year, whereas France, Italy, Spain are improving their outcomes, we seem to be getting worse. So lots and lots of problems, mainly due to alcohol. But we're not the only country having problems with cirrhosis. In the UK, it's the fifth largest cause of death, peaking at 59 years. In USA, it's 12th, Italy, 6th, Germany, the 10th largest cause of death. So big problem worldwide. And certainly, just because we're in this part of the world, you will see that compared to Eastern European countries, we're actually rather benefiting, really, compared to the very high rates we see in Hungary, Romania, and elsewhere. And again, this reflects increased alcohol use. So I don't need to remind this audience that when we think about patients with HIV, we have alcohol, we have the usual cause of liver disease, but there are perhaps more important areas that shared routes of transmission of HIV and viral infections, recreational therapeutic drugs, metabolic diseases and NASH, and you've heard about all these in previous talks, so I won't dwell on this. But just to say there is a well-known problem with liver disease in HIV-infected individuals. We've heard that the HCV course is accelerated in HIV-infected patients, and the prevalence of HBV co-infection is as high as 17% in some populations. Old data now, but the first one to really highlight the fact that in the highly active retroviral treatment era, the prevalent cause of death in patients with HIV is become liver disease, so a big problem. So what I'd like to do in this talk is really talk about the complications of end-stage liver disease, particularly prevention, recognition, not so much on management, but management for you in terms of prophylaxis and screening. I'm not going to get into the technicalities of how I manage esophageal varices, etc. That's not really relevant to the talk. We'll talk about liver transplantation, who should be considered for transplantation, when they should be considered for transplantation, and increasingly how, what sort of transplants should we be offering. And that leads into the challenges that we're going to see in patients who are HIV positive and co-infected patients, because there are real challenges that we're about to face in terms of the diminishing organ pool and the type of organs we're able to offer your patients. You know that the progression of fibrosis to cirrhosis, as Sanjay has very eloquently described, you start off with a normal liver, portal fibrosis, ended up in cirrhosis. This is a flux, as Sanjay described. You can heal, you can get cirrhosis from repetitive injury. And increasingly, we see with long-term viral control, we might be able to reverse cirrhosis, but it's by no means guaranteed. So what we need to do is obviously try and avoid getting to the cirrhotic state in the first place. But assuming you get cirrhosis, that's when things start to become problematic. This is my interpretation of this Castellari's data from 2008, and you'll see that the overall prevalence of cirrhosis in patients with HIV was about 8.3%. The majority of that, hepatitis C, And you can see, if you drill down into what those manifestations of cirrhosis were at the time of diagnosis of cirrhosis, the majority of patients had evidence of portal hypertension with splenomegaly and esophageal varices, and about a third had evidence of decompensation with variceal bleeding or ascites. So portal hypertension is the dominant presenting feature of cirrhosis, and it's portal hypertension, high pressure in the portal vein due to resistance of blood flow through the liver, that drives all the complications of cirrhosis. Portal hypertension causes complex changes in the systemic hemodynamics, which leads to ascites and eventually renal failure, and the presence of collaterals leads to variceal bleeding, hepatic encephalopathy, and complex changes in the circulation of the heart and lungs. So it all really depends on portal hypertension. In terms of grading the severity of cirrhosis, you all know that this is the Charles Pugh grade. This has been around since 1970-odd, was originally developed as a score of determining mortality in patients undergoing surgery with cirrhosis. But it's interesting that it still to this day, it's one of the most accurate ways of assessing prognosis in patients with cirrhosis. And depending on scores that you attributed to the grade of encephalopathy, presence of ascites, degree of jaundice, a degree of synthetic dysfunction defined by albumin and INR, you can come up with three groups of patients, Charles Pugh A, B, and C, and they have very, very different outcomes. So for patients with what we call well-compensated Charles Pugh A cirrhosis, the outcome over a year is actually not bad. It's not 100%, but if you've got Charles Pugh C or Charles Pugh B disease, you can be pretty sure that that patient is going to be lucky to survive 5 to 10 years. So Charles Pugh score gives us a reasonable idea of prognosis, but one of the things I wanted to highlight was, even if you've got somebody with cirrhosis who's well compensated with a normal INR, a normal bilirubin, they can still have an appreciable mortality. And as we come to assess or understand how people progress through cirrhosis, we can define some clinical stages. Clinical stage one is cirrhosis in the absence of any varices, ascites, or any other complication. As you progress through the stages, the first thing to appear is varices, then you get ascites, the ascites bleeding, and the most appalling prognostic group is those patients who are cirrhotic with sepsis or renal failure who have a terrible prognosis. If you look, this is nice data from Nottingham in a large group of patients, following up patients with defined cirrhosis just to see what happened to them over a year of follow-up. And you can see that these patients with stage one, who are these patients with compensated cirrhosis, no ascites, no varices. If you follow those up over a year, 10% will have died from complications of liver disease. So just because your patient is actually pretty well, they've got cirrhosis, they haven't got any varices, does not mean they're not at risk. And you can see that significant proportions of these patients will progress quite quickly to different stages of cirrhosis, going straight from stage one to stage three or even stage four with GI bleeding over a short space of time. So what you need to do is find your patients with cirrhosis and start surveying them. So the principles of management of somebody with cirrhosis is, first of all, making the diagnosis. Biopsy is not useful as a screening tool, but certainly in patients you suspect of having cirrhosis, I think is the preferred method of making that diagnosis. Having made the diagnosis, or at least being suspicious of it, there's nothing to stop you screening already for complications such as hepatocellular carcinoma and varices. And it's amazing how poorly this is done, even within the hepatological community. If patients have got ascites, you can save lives just with the simple addition of prophylactic antibiotics into their management. Complications must be obviously managed aggressively and involve your hepatologist or gastroenterologist early. And I hope I'll show you later that actually we should be referring patients much earlier for liver transplantation. And I would argue that it's never really too early. Just to really highlight the use of FibroScan in making the diagnosis, it is seemingly quite useful for F4 metavir. Your cutoff of really above 15 seems to be quite valid. But if you look at the area under the ROC curve, it's certainly not greater than 0.8 or so. It's better than the other non-invasive scores, but transient elastography will miss some patients with important degrees of fibrosis. And this was a meta-analysis that was presented a couple of years ago at the BSG from one of our group with 40 studies comparing FibroScan to liver biopsy, and this is across the board, not just in HIV patients. And we obviously many varied cutoffs between F2 and cirrhosis, different cutoffs between disease, and overall we found that a positive test, whatever your cutoff, gives a post-test probability of about 88%, not 100%. And significant disease can be missed in 15 to 20% of patients if you solely rely on FibroScan. So I would go back to that you have to look for some sort of concordance. Maybe clinical suspicion and the FibroScan result will be enough to confirm it. But if the FibroScan result doesn't seem to tally, your clinical suspicion is high, the platelet count's a bit low and you don't quite know why, the spleen's a bit bigger than you would imagine, I think the next thing you would do is think of going for a liver biopsy. So the transjugular liver biopsy, the beauty of this procedure is it can be done on a sedated patient. They don't have to hold their breath. It's very comfortable. You do the biopsy from inside the hepatic vein, which is obviously there are no pain fibers on the inside of the liver, so that's pain-free. You can confirm immediately by injecting contrast down the hepatic vein that there's no leak of contrast from the capsule of the liver. And then you can say to that patient when the procedure's finished, we'll do one set of observations, you can go home. There's no lying on the side for 6 hours, 6 hours of observation. They don't get the shoulder tip pain. They don't need to stay in because of concerns about complications. And increasingly, we use this as our only route of biopsy. The beauty of a transjugular liver biopsy is you can take repeated cores. Anybody in this room who does liver biopsies will know that taking more than one core increases the risk. With a transjugular liver biopsy, you don't increase the risk. You can take multiple cores, one for fax analysis, three for histology, whatever you want. So our standard of practice now has become to take four cores, and with four cores of liver, you can guarantee a median length of 24 millimeters. Over 85% of them will be greater than 2 centimeters, which is more than adequate for an accurate histological diagnosis in viral hepatitis. And you guarantee 15 portal tracks. For those people who follow the literature of liver biopsy, this would be considered a very good liver biopsy, and this is obtained without pain for the patient. So, particular bugbear of mine, because I have to get up in the middle of the night and scope these patients, is varices and how badly we manage this complication. Given that we know that patients with cirrhosis, having made the diagnosis, even in compensated cirrhotics, 30% of them will have varices. If they're decompensated, 60% of them will have varices. Small varices get larger, and the larger they get, the more they bleed. So if you leave varices alone, even small ones, 10% of the patients will have bled by 2 years. And the mortality of that first bleed remains very high, 25 to 50%. And this is potentially avoidable. If we survey for varices, we can find small varices like this. We can say, right, we'll bring you back in a year's time. Oh, I see they've enlarged. Now is the time to intervene with either giving a non-selective beta blocker or indeed providing esophageal banding. What you want to avoid is people developing angry varices like this with little hemocystic red spots that are likely to pop and bleed at any point. So we want to be finding patients with small varices, following them closely, intervening at this stage. This was meant to be a video of a large variceal bleed. You can see a jet of blood coming from a varix just at the gastroesophageal junction. These can be very difficult to control in the emergency situation, and if you do your primary prophylaxis properly, you can avoid it. You have three drugs to use, propranolol, nadolol, or timolol. Non-selected beta blockers at reasonable doses will prevent variceal hemorrhage. Variceal banding for those patients who are intolerant to beta blockers is an adequate alternative, but is more expensive. So if you think about propranolol, how cheap it is, just providing, and every single trial using propranolol has been positive in terms of reducing the incidence of first variceal hemorrhage. For what is essentially 14 pence per week, you can prevent 40% of the variceal bleeding. So it's a very, very safe, effective treatment. That was my variceal banding video, which hasn't worked, but that was just to show that banding is an alternative if a patient can't take beta blockers. What isn't an alternative is just to do nothing. So all patients with cirrhosis should be endoscoped at diagnosis. If they have no varices, they get rescoped in 2 to 3 years. Small varices, rescope in a year. And if they've enlarged to medium or large varices, you start primary prophylaxis. And for those patients who are intolerant to beta blockers, they should have banding. Now, you can use other ways of predicting varices. Something as simple as the platelet count can give you a good indication of whether the patient's developing significant portal hypertension. As the spleen enlarges, and I realize this is obviously difficult in patients who are co-infected with HIV, but in the general cirrhotic population, as the platelet count drops, that means an increase in portal hypertension, and that can predict the presence of varices. So we have all these tools, FibroScan, platelet count, regular endoscopy. You would have thought that we're able to prevent most bleeds in the UK. Well, frankly, we can't, because we're incompetent at even following these simple guidelines. This was a nice study that was presented, never made it into publication, but I think it has an important message from this abstract back in 2006. This is one hospital, 135 admissions with variceal bleeding, 49 were first episodes of bleeds. In 32 patients, they were already known to have cirrhosis, but only 20 had been referred to a gastroenterologist. And of the 17 attended, only 11 had actually had an endoscopy. And of those that had an endoscopy, 8 had been found to have varices, but only 6 had received adequate primary prophylaxis. So I think this is probably repeated across the UK. Simple medicine done very, very badly. You know, you potentially, 32 patients could have, of these patients, 32, only 6 received beta blockers. I think that's a terrible indictment of the way we practice medicine in the UK. Another thing that we get wrong is our management and screening for hepatocellular carcinoma. When you present with large tumours like this, there really is nothing that you can do for that patient other than make a diagnosis and palliate their pain. This is a reasonably sized hepatoma arising within a cirrhotic liver. Again, this is a tumour which is too big. We want to find tumours that are small so that we can treat them. The risk of chronic liver disease of any type increases the risk of HCC, and you will know that HCC is an increasing problem in HIV-infected individuals. The bottom line is, of your HCC patients, certainly in the UK, Western Europe, 90% of them will have cirrhosis. So what that means is that your cirrhotics are at high risk. Whatever the cause of their cirrhosis, they're at high risk of hepatoma, and you need to start surveying them. If you wait for a clinical presentation of hepatocellular carcinoma, which would be with right upper quadrant pain or decompensation of previously stable cirrhosis, you have very few treatment options other than the odd patient who might benefit from systemic therapy or indeed just palliative care. So the recommendation is that all patients who perceived to be at risk should have surveillance ultrasound every 6 months. It's not perfect. You cannot diagnose every tumour, but your aim is to identify early stage disease because that's the only time that you can afford a cure. The reason for doing ultrasound every 6 months is because as these tumours develop from dysplastic nodules, they get slightly bigger. As they get more and more dysplastic and get and turn into cancer, they become more increasingly visible on ultrasound. And ultrasound is good at distinguishing hepatocellular carcinomas of around 1 to 2 centimetres from high-grade dysplastic nodules. Not perfect, but good enough. So the recommendations currently for who should have surveillance have changed. It used to be everybody with cirrhosis, but now the recommendations from the most recent guidelines are that even patients with hepatitis C and advanced fibrosis, so not quite cirrhotic, but advanced fibrosis, should be offered surveillance. All patients with cirrhosis, obviously, apart from those patients with decompensated cirrhosis, because by then it's too late, they haven't got a treatment option unless they're already on a liver transplant waiting list. And I think importantly, reflecting the fact that patients with hepatitis B are at risk of hepatocellular carcinoma, even in the absence of cirrhosis, you should be screening Asians greater than 40 years, Africans greater than the age of 20, and those with a family history of HCC. We want to avoid patients presented with large liver masses. As I said, the specificity is pretty good for ultrasound in 1 to 2 centimetre nodules. Sensitivity not great. You can increase the sensitivity by using CT or MRI, but that's far too expensive, and the radiation involved is prohibitive. So we're really left with ultrasound. And there have been two large, not brilliantly performed studies looking at the impact of ultrasound in preventing hepatocellular carcinoma. Both have shown an improvement in mortality, and both have shown an increase in the prevalence of tumors diagnosed at a treatable stage. There will never, and these have been done in the Far East, there will never be a randomized trial in the West, because certainly if I had cirrhosis, I would not sign up to a randomized trial of surveillance versus no surveillance. So the best data we have is that it picks up tumors at a smaller, more treatable stage, and perhaps there's an improvement in mortality. Should we use alpha fetoprotein protein in surveillance? I would say no. He certainly shouldn't use it alone. I think to use it alone is definitely a no-no. The reason being is that only 10 to 20% of small tumors present with a high AFP. So by the time, if you're relying on alpha-fetoprotein protein, and by the time your alpha-fetoprotein protein has gone up to 200, you're probably dealing with an untreatable hepatocellular carcinoma. So alpha-fetoprotein protein alone is a no-no. But in fact, combining alpha-fetoprotein protein and ultrasound increases your diagnosis rate of small tumors by only 6 to 8%, but doubles the cost of the whole surveillance program, which is, I would say, the juice is probably not worth the squeeze in that. If you're going to do a surveillance program, it needs to be done properly in an organized way, and that's expensive. And doubling the cost of it for the sake of increasing yield by 6% probably can't be justified. Having said that, I will hold up my hand and say that I tick the box for alpha-fetoprotein protein every time I request an ultrasound. If you find a nodule on ultrasound, your next test is a CT or an MRI scan. And it's, a tribute to our imaging colleagues that we can now diagnose hepatocellular carcinoma accurately without resorting to a liver biopsy. And certainly in a cirrhotic liver, you will see the tumor during the arterial phase of the scan lights up here with contrast. And during the portal venous phase of the scan, you can see becomes dark against the background of the liver. That enhancement and washout pattern, absolutely typical for hepatocellular carcinoma, 98% certain, it can't be anything else, don't need to do a biopsy, just need to get on and treat that patient. And talking of treatment, and I think this is where it really, the message needs to go home, that surveillance to find small nodules is the key to beating hepatocellular carcinoma, because unless you've got early stage disease with single nodules that are small or three nodules less than 3 centimeters, you are essentially outside of any curative treatment. So only these patients with early stage disease, single small nodules or small nodules less than 3 centimeters, are going to actually have a chance of cure. If you've got no chance of a curative treatment, then look how your survival goes down from a 5-year survival of 40 to 70%. To actually an overall survival of 20 months. So that's a big drop-off in survival. So you must get surveying your patients to try and find those patients with early-stage hepatocellular carcinoma. Now, assuming that you've done your surveillance, you've prevented the variceal bleed, you've surveyed the tumour, but patient's still deteriorating, you're going to have to start thinking about liver transplantation. And liver transplantation now is a routine procedure that's offered throughout Europe. It started, obviously, back in any appreciable numbers back in 83, which is when our program started at the Royal Free. And as you see, there was an explosion of activity in Europe over the next 20 years. Leveled off over the last few years for reasons that I'll come back to, but you can see that this has been one of the success stories in hepatology over the last 20 years. In terms of success, there's no doubt now that we can offer patients excellent survival following liver transplantation. Not perfect, but improving all the time. So you see these two cohorts from 1968 to 1988. These were the early days of liver transplantation. Survival was not great. Early mortality, long-term survival, unusual. But just in the following 20 years, you can see that massive improvements in survival. Routinely, we offer our patients greater than 90% one-year survival and can offer them greater than 70% five-year survival. And that's in the face of recurrent disease, transplantation for cancer, etc. And I want you to hold that five-year survival rate of 70% in your minds when we look at the survival following hepatocellular carcinoma, following transplantation for HIV. So who should get a transplant? Well, The easiest thing to say is that those patients who are expected to derive a survival benefit from transplantation should be offered it. And that is where the risk of dying liver disease is greater than the risk of dying from the transplant. And at the moment in the UK, that is taken as a cutoff of 9%. The average mortality at 1 year in the UK following liver transplantation is 9%. So therefore, if your perceived risk of dying from your liver disease is greater than 9%, you should be offered a liver transplant. Now, it's interesting, we used a formula called UKELD, which is the UK end-stage liver disease score, which is a modification of MEL derived from over 4,000 patients on the UK liver transplant waiting list. And we've used this score to come up with a cutoff that predicts a one-year predicted mortality of 9%. And it's amazing to see, you can get this calculator from the UK transplant website, that you only need an INR of 1.3 and a serum bilirubin of 35 in the context of cirrhosis to have a risk of mortality of greater than 9%, UKELD score of 49. This is somebody that can be registered for a liver transplant and would be expected to derive a survival advantage. So this is pretty mild disease, and I'm sure you've got lots of patients in your clinics with mild disease like this. You're thinking, well, that's not too bad. Bilirubin's only 35, INR's 1.3, the transplant hepatologists wouldn't be interested in that. Well, certainly in the UK we would be, especially in HIV-related conditions, and for reasons I'll expand on later. So that's who we should think about giving a liver transplant to, but what are the other things we need to balance? Well, we need to think about a utilitarian argument. This is a scarce resource, so surely we should only be giving these livers to people who are going to benefit in the long term. And we have a sort of, it's not based on any data, but we have a concept that we should only really be offering liver transplantation, certainly in the UK, where the expected survival is greater than 50% at 5 years, with a quality of life that's acceptable to the patient. And this means we need to pay attention to the indication, comorbidities, the chance of recurrent disease, and, of course, the age of the patient, because that will all factor in how the patient is likely to survive. So we may have patients who will definitely die without a liver transplant, but if they're going to only survive 6-7 months or, you know, a year and a half following the transplant, we've got other candidates who might benefit more. So we have to balance these sort of justice arguments versus utilitarian argument when we consider who to transplant. And this figure, I think, is useful to hold in your mind when we look at the results for liver transplantation in HIV. So this is the last cohort of survival figures, 1 year survival figures in the UK liver transplant centres. And you can see that overall mortality at 1 year varies between 4 and 10%. That's pretty good numbers. And I think, you know, any transplant centre would be proud to show their figures and say, aren't we doing very well? But I think these figures hide the real scandal that's going on in liver transplantation at the moment, and that is the excessive rate of death on the list, certainly in the UK, because of the shortage of organs. And you can see that of the patients that actually get registered on the list, survival really at a year is less than 75%, and the reason for that is because we lose about 20% of patients waiting for a transplant. And the answer to this is going to be, in the UK at least, that rather than allowing us in our centre to say, this patient's now on the waiting list, we've got this offer, I want to transplant this individual, we're moving in the UK inexorably based on liver transplantation, based on need defined by disease severity, which means that the sicker you are, the more likely you are to get a transplant. And that would seem intuitively very good, but the problem is there are some groups of patients, hepatitis C and especially HIV, HCV co-infected patients, who will do very poorly under that sort of scheme. The difficulty we have is that we have tried hard to increase the number of donors in the UK and we haven't managed to do it. We've increased the number of patients on the waiting list and we've increased the numbers of patients who are number of livers that we're using that are older and more marginal. We've increased the numbers of donors coming from donors after cardiac death rather than brain dead donors, which are these donors are considered inferior due to a higher rate of biliary complications and primary non-function. And we're using more fatty grafts. We're using grafts from patients who've died from brain cancer. These are, you know, organs that we would never have used 15 years ago. And the problem is that even despite opening up the margins like this, we've still not increased the number of organs, and the number of deaths on the list increases. So what are our answers to that? Well, certainly in Europe, we've started, people have started to try and use marginal organs, reduced size grafts, splitting livers into two, giving half a liver to a baby, the other half to an adult. And at the Royal Free, we've been really trying to push forward the concept of live donor transplant. And I just show you this because I think it's a good example of what can be achieved. This young man, back in January, developed acute liver failure. He was listed for liver transplantation, having fulfilled poor prognostic criteria. And after 5 days on the super urgent waiting list, no donor was forthcoming, which is unusual and I think reflects the changing dynamics of the list in the UK. This was the guy who was the best man at his wedding and has been a lifelong friend, who kindly came forward to offer the right lobe of his liver. And you can see very nice scar there, and this guy did extremely well. Now, the normal workup process for a live donor transplant can take up to 6 weeks. Because he was in acute liver failure, we had to do it all in 2 days. It's enormously expensive, it's emotionally draining for all the team involved, and it is not really the answer for the organ shortage, but this is the extremes that we're being forced to try and provide organs for our patients at the moment. And to put this in context of the type of patients that you're seeing, I'm not going to talk about transplantation in HIV positive individuals across the board, because you all know that for every other indication other than HCV, the outcomes are excellent, if not better than standard indications. So I'm going to talk just about hepatitis C co-infection. And these are just a collection of studies, all very small over the past sort of few years. And they show, on the whole, sort of acceptable one-year survival rates. But the 3 and 5 year survival rates where they're reported are actually dismal. You know, we should be offering patients transplantation when we expect 50% of them or more to survive 5 years. And some of these studies are falling way below that. Again, in small groups. And these are collections of patients amassed over many years. But this sort of data has led to a little bit of pessimism about transplanting of patients with HCV and HIV co-infection. And I think you can see that pessimism when you look at data like this. And this is comparing HIV positive patients to non-HIV positive waitlisted patients, just looking at what happens to them when they're on the waiting list. And you can see that if you're HIV positive, you're less likely to get to transplant, you're more likely to die on the list, and your 90-day, 180-day, 360-day waitlist survival is much lower than non-HIV infected controls. Why is that? I think it's very difficult to say. It probably reflects a more rapid decompensation in HIV positive individuals whilst waiting for transplant. It might also reflect, I'm sad to say, an unwillingness to take on patients with perceived higher risk of a poor outcome, because we all have to report our survival figures into national audits and we're all being judged on how we perform. So I think that this is a secret story about what might be happening to some of the patients on the list. I think we are drilling down now and getting a bit more experience as more multi-center prospective studies are being published, and we can actually start to work out who is actually going to benefit from transplantation with HIV and Hep C, and we can be a bit more intelligent then about how we approach it. So this is the Spanish multicenter study. This is comparing 5 year survival for co-infected HIV Hep C compared to HCV mono-infected, and you can see the 5 year survival barely scratches the 50% cutoff that we would normally like to see. But this is a good study. It's multi-center and allows you to look at what factors predict a poor outcome. And we know that that's genotype 1, a high pre-liver transplant MELD score, so more severe liver disease going in. And that links in with what I said before. If we move to purely organ allocation system based on disease severity, your patients are not going to win, because they do very poorly if you transplant them when they're very sick. And as you might imagine, centers doing less than one HIV positive transplant a year, that is an independent risk factor for a poor outcome, as you might imagine. And these data are pretty much supported by data from a US multicenter study published this year. again showing inferior one-year survival, inferior prolonged survival compared to mono-infected HCV transplants. And again, this is interesting because it allows us to actually pull out what might be important here. In this study, they found there were higher rates of rejection in the patients who were HIV hep C co-infected. Does this reflect greater immune dysregulation? Possibly. Does it in fact reflect our reluctance to use calcineurin inhibitors in big doses because of drug interactions, and actually we're erring on the side of underdosing rather than providing these drugs in effective concentrations? They noted that there was a poorer outcome in patients with higher donor age and patients receiving with more severe disease who needed combined liver kidney transplants, and patients with a lower BMI reflecting malnutrition, usually as a feature of advanced liver disease. So you can pull these things together and start saying, well, okay, who does badly with transplantation with HIV and hep C, and who could potentially do well, and what could we do about it? We can definitely try harder to avoid rejection. We can, rather than avoiding steroids, we should be using more steroids and tapering them slowly. And that will avoid these big peaks and troughs that we're getting in the use of tacrolimus and cyclosporine because of interactions with the protease inhibitors, etc. As new drugs come online, we might be able to change regimens completely and start using our immunosuppressives in the normal way, and we might see less rejection and therefore better outcomes. We should be trying to use younger donors in our HIV hep C population. At least we should avoid older donors and marginal grafts. It's difficult in systems like the UK because these are the only grafts that we're getting at the moment, but perhaps we need to actually provide a different priority or a different way of assessing and listing patients with HIV co-infection in order for them to benefit. We need to give them priority on the list beyond just disease severity. I think there needs to be an intelligent appreciation of the fact that these patients deteriorate quicker and do badly if they're transplanted when they're very sick. So I think responsibility is on us as transplant doctors to do this. They should be managed in experienced centres. The hepatitis C recurrence story, it won't be easy in a HIV hep C co-infected population post-transplant, but at least it offers some hope for the future. So I'm just going to conclude and say that cirrhosis is common, and what you can do is screen for complications. Identify and refer transplant candidates early, and it's never too early. And novel approaches need to counteract this growing pessimism about transplantation and co-infection. And that means us as transplant physicians to work on organ allocation, immunosuppression, and treatment of HCV. And I thank you for your attention. Thank you.